नमस्ते, गुड मॉर्निंग ब्रदर्स एंड सिस्टर्स, लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन थ्रू आउट द वर्ल्ड, दोज हु आर लिसनिंग फ्रॉम द फील्ड ऑफ साइंस, इंजीनियरिंग, रिलीजन, कॉमर्स एंड आर्ट्स, professionals and officials and the most honorable venerable prime minister, minister, doctors, fathers, I Dr. Akesh from USA welcome all. Today we will know the facts of science and spirituality. When one reads a literary text following the traditional approach, he may put questions like what message does the author convey or what is the artistic achievement of the writer. According to traditional view, the writer is conceived in Wordsworth's terms as a man speaking to man. The traditional approach is based on the biography of the author, and the critics interpret text with the help of certain incidents occurred in his lifetime. The intention of the author is the meaning of the text. Some traditional critics would interpret literature within a text of a philosophical thought of a period or group. Johnson's interpretations of Shakespeare and other poets are based on this technique. Next, we come across a few critics who don't belong to any particular school, but their ideas were explored and developed by later critics. They are T.S. Eliot, everyone who is the student of literature have read it in American literature. They are T.S. Eliot, I.A. Richards and W.P. Empson. The editors of critical text call them the transcendentalists. Eliot established himself as a magistrally influential voice in English literary criticism. He declared himself to be a classicist in literature, an Anglo-Catholic in religion, and a royalist in politics. His provocative essays, which are anti-romantic in both style and content, disdain close reading. Eliot's criticism parallels his own poetry in an oblique, but revealing way. Eliot writes in one of his essays that his criticism was a byproduct of his own poetry workshop. He says that meaning is to be found within the text and not outside it. Tradition and individual talent is a scathing attack on intentional fallacy. In the function of criticism, Eliot disposed of the affective fallacy. A number of Eliot's bewitching phrases, such as the dissociation of sensibility and the objective correlative, have passed into the general currency of criticism. I.A. Richards' book, Principles of Literary Criticism, set out to establish a theoretical framework for criticism. Richards sees the methods of experimental science as the only sure means of attaining reliability in between the referential language of science and the emotive language of poetry. According to Richards, poetry belongs to a separate emotive dimension of language. Richards advises the readers of poetry that they should learn to read in aright. They should learn to write, to read it aright. The reader should understand the fact that poets deal in varieties of pseudo statements and note the truthful proportions. For Richards, poetic truth is a matter of emotive transaction beyond all reach of logical critic. W.P. Ampson's The Structure of Complex Words was a full-scale rejoinder to I.A. Richards' theories. He argued that we should not go too far towards emotional roots. Poetry should be accountable to all usual students' standards of rational prose sense. For Ampson, poetry is not emotive but cognitive. In Seven Types of Ambiguity, Ampson investigated the multiplicity of meaning. Contemporary critics hold the view that meaning does not matter in poetry because it is appreciated as pure sound and the cultivation of a belief in so-called atmosphere vitiated much 19th century poetry. For Ampson, autobiographers can only be producer of meaning, and the attempt to manufacture it for its own sake as mistaken. Another influential literary figure who changed the map of literary history was F.R. Lewis. He does not belong to any school, nor does he have any theory of his own. He defined criticism as the experience of one's own reading. He preached and practiced an approach to literature which advocated close attention to the text and encouraged sharp discrimination in evaluating what was read. Lewis follows Eliot in finding in the metaphysical poet's qualities which 20th century writers separately needed to recover. In the books New Bearings in English Poetry and Re-evaluation, he assails the popular conventions of poetic evaluation. Lewis believed that some authors are better than others, and establishing such preferences is the very lifeblood of Lewis's criticism. Freudian critics tend to demonstrate the general adherence of the text to universal psychological truths rather than consider specific characteristics. The most controversial aspect of psychoanalytic criticism is its tendency to interpret imagery in terms of sexuality. Following Freudian theory, the psychoanalytic critic tends to see all concave images, ponds, flowers, cups, etc., as female or unique symbols, and all images whose length exceeds their diameter towards mountain, peaks, knives as male or phallic symbols. Marxist critics believe that literature is a social and material practice related to other social practices and finally explicable only in these terms. For Marxism, history does not form a single category of seamless whole. It is grasped rather as a field of conflicting interests and forces. Lukács in the essay The Ideology of Modernism attacks the modernist writers because they present man in a solitariness seemingly basic to the human condition. Man is seen as incapable of relationships with others. The Marxist critics' basic objection to modernism lies in its loss of the Aristotelian view of man as a social animal. For the new critics, every poem is a verbal icon, a structure of a wrought theoretical figure. They argued forcefully that